Sri JLakhani, an excellent communicator of Hinduism in Britain and director of the Hindu Academy, the Vivekananda Centre in London. Over the last 15 years, Sri JLakhani has given talks on Hinduism to thousands of youngsters at English schools, colleges, and universities. If you wish to get a glimpse of the modern, dynamic face of Hinduism, then do not miss this series of talks.
To you, Dilip Bhai, is in your talks you are sort of asserting the religion. So how important is it to, you know, assert and even, you know, try to revive the religion from where people are actually moving away from?
First of all, I agree with the analysis. We are living in a secular world, and we are beginning to notice that religions have been a burden on humanity. It has created tremendous pressures, tensions, and a lot of atrocities have been committed in the name of religion. A lot of superstitions have paraded in the name of religion. We still do it. All of us are still, you know, in a way, at the mercy of some of the superstitions that come in the name of religion. We are caught. So we are saying we are enlightened, humanity has evolved, has moved forward further, and much more, you know, intellectually, you know, advanced. And, you know, if you look at the graph of advancement of humanity in the last 50 years, it's almost exponential. In the last 50 years, the dramatic changes that are like quantum and stuff is so dramatic. It's very thrilling. So we are kind of accelerating faster and faster all the time. So this is the real world that we live in. Strongly science-oriented, rationally founded, reasonably balanced, intellectually challenging, and yet is not able to sit well with the religious lobby or the religious ideas and saying these are atrocities. That's why you have Richard Dawkins in this world. They are reflecting this issue that religions have been perhaps harmful to humanity. Should we flick it away? Look, this is what he's saying. Should we flick it away? Leave it alone. It's done its job and whatever, but we leave it alone. Let's just follow a secular lifestyle. We better, you know, in every sense. But just, this has been a burden on humanity pushed aside. This is the question. Look, it is not me who is going to decide, it's humanity that's going to decide. The answer will not come from me. It's not just waiting for my broadcast to decide what to do. It will decide, humanity decides. But I am an optimist at heart. I'm an optimist. So when people say, oh, people are losing interest in religion, over there, I say, no. They are rediscovering what is called religion in a different guise. So when I meet great intellectuals who are strongly science-oriented, who are rational, who are lovely human beings, I feel more comfortable with them than I feel with people of religion. Can you imagine? This is reality. I see them much more flowing, much more easygoing, much more honest. Look, the British Humanist Association is an example. I love those guys. They are atheists, and they're telling me this nonsense, Jay, all this religion, nonsense. But I still love them, because when I look at the way they live, the way they think, the way they are open to ideas, suggestions, I fall in love. Didn't I say spiritual democracy? We encourage, we love these ideas. So here is this world. Should we completely flick away religions? This is the kind of blunt question. My answer is this. Just because one particular enterprise was misused or created atrocities or continues to carry a lot of superstitions, doesn't mean that it is completely rotten. All we can do, or all we should do, is in a way remove some of the superstitions, discard them, acknowledge the atrocities that we have committed in the name of it. That's all you need to do, acknowledge it. Suppose we Hindus have acknowledged here that we were very nasty to our own people. We have been very nasty. Look, people of other religions have been nasty to people of other religions. It's record, historic record. The Christian treatment of people in South America, North, wherever, was very cruel. They were chopping them to pieces, saying you are animals, or convert them. So they were very cruel, and they were going in the name of Christianity and crusades and all that. They were very cruel. So in the name of religion, they have done tremendous atrocity to people of other religion. What did the Hindus do? In the name of religion, they have committed tremendous atrocity on their own people. If this is a good part of religion, this is the good part, that you did damage your own people, not others outside your religion. That's the only good part. But we have done tremendous harm. Look, Modern India is the best example of what you can do to people of, who are on the lower rung of society. You crush them. Who cares in modern India? 30-40% population doesn't have sewage or clean drinking water. Do we care? We just carry on. They let them, you know, they have to just keep working. They're bungies. See? So we have committed a lot of atrocity in the name of, we continue to do that in the name of religion. Does it mean we discard all of religion? No. We discovered that this particular phenomena we have discovered has been misused. So because it is misused, doesn't mean its validity is gone or its potency is gone. Suppose you discover atomic energy. And with that, you can light up all the homes in London straight away with very little, you know, raw material. But the same atom bomb can be used to destroy Hiroshima and Nagasaki and kill millions of people. Because it did that atrocity doesn't mean now you must not mention the word atomic energy. No, we'll need it. If not now, the coal energy and the fossil fuel will run out. We'll need it. We'll have to go and crack coconuts at the feet of atomic energy saying, please come back and help us. We'll have to do it with all the dangers. So in the same way, when you discover a feature, or if you find certain discovery which we call religious, used or misused, carrying a lot of baggage as well, and yet very potent. So my response is, don't flick it out. Push away the kind of crustacean it has gathered of superstition. Push it away. Also push away all the nonsense that parades in the name of religion, which are just nothing but superstitions. Again, recognize this potent, powerful thing that we discovered that has used been that can be used or misused. And make sure that you use it, just like atomic energy, you use it rather than produce atom bombs and knock each other out. In the same way, I'm saying don't kick out, it's like saying don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. This is what I'm saying. The bathwater has become dirty and you want to get rid of it. Same way the religions have become dirty or muddied. Doesn't mean you throw out. You tidy it, you filter it. Because it has got a lot of potency, a lot of power. Look, didn't I just show you some of the ideas, the heart of Indian metaphysics kind of resonate well with ideas of physical sciences. See, this is the role of religion. It gives greater credence to science and it will help science progress faster and further. So there is a role for religions and the role will be different. It will be more to do with spiritual humanism and these ideas of broader ideas of vision of spiritual democracy. This is what it will focus. But this is where, if you like, religions will continue to play a part in modern society. So I don't want to throw the baby with the bathwater, dirty bathwater. I want to hang on to the baby. It has been produced after a tremendous amount of effort of the great likes of Kapil and Patanjali and Vivekananda. So we can't discard it.
The babies are innocent. Baby born, okay, it's nothing. It's his previous life, maybe some percentage, but maybe 80 or 90% of the parents, maybe they got testing or I don't know what is exactly. Thank you.
These are very good questions. I'm pleased that we asked Sujit Bhai to ask the question. They're very, very good questions. And I think a lot of people in the lot of viewers are struggling with these ideas. If you see an innocent child suffering with some serious illness, let's say, just born and suffering, because we are Hindus, we immediately say, oh, the law of karma is taking effect, the poor chap, he must have done bad things in his life, so that he, the poor chap is suffering. This would be the immediate response of an average Hindu. This is terrible, terrible. How dare you blame this baby for the sufferings undergoing? Don't you realize? What happens to the young child is not the result of just his action, but a lot of other things that combine together and produce that illness or the sickness. A lot of other things have all... Don't you notice, look, you know, in your own lives, the amount of effort you put in and the result you get is strongly influenced by a lot of other things, whether your parents were able to pay the fees and send you to the top school, or whether your mom helped you with the homework. All these things had to kind of influence and in a way interact with you before you produce a result. Your own contribution was perhaps trivial, literally 1%. 99% is the environment and other features that in a way infringed on you and your situation. In the same way, when somebody's suffering, somebody's got illness, somebody's got disabled, if you blame that person, say, you deserve it, this is terrible, don't you do that, don't you ever, Hindus, don't you ever dare do it, you don't understand the law of karma. Infinite things almost happen, combined together, produce one result. And the contribution of that individual may be very trivial, very little, so don't blame the poor chap. Never vilify anybody in that manner. Never look down on anybody. This is the mature idea of law of karma. So I'm saying, a lot of things are adding together, where your contribution is also important, but it's also minor, recognize it. So don't blame yourself, Don't be indifferent to your own suffering or indifferent to suffering of others, saying in the name of law of karma, nobody deserves it. That's the first part. So be very careful about how you express the idea of law of karma and do not vilify or undermine anybody. Second part is very important. I like this. You see, I can see the heart here kind of getting grieved that here is Ramakrishna, here is Raman Maharshi. Both of them suffer from cancer. You might ask yourself, did they do bad karma in the past life? They are getting caught out. Oh no, my friend, this is the answer. In reality, neither of these individuals, despite the thing, oh, I've got pain here, despite that, neither of these individuals felt the pain. I said, oh, they didn't feel the pain, they had cancer. One in the throat and one on the shoulder. Oh dear, no, don't you realize? These people, when they touch base with the spirit, the idea that I am the Atman, I am the spirit, they are established in that state throughout. Once you get touch base with it, you can't let go. Because you discovered it, it can't be undone. You're done. Once you do that, physical suffering appears so trivial. It's like a little mosquito bite or something. It hardly hits them. So please do not go under the... Have you seen? You know, when you see some of the films, in the Hindi films, used to come with bhaktas, you know, all these Prahlad and suffering and crying. You say, oh dear, poor, I don't want to be a bhakta. In fact, that's what my reaction. I said, these are terrible. These guys undergo such you know, severe testing. I'd rather not go through that process. Have you noticed? All the bhaktas, you know, they cry and they get leprosy and they get everything until they sing to Mother Goddess and things sort out. I don't want to go through that whole process. I said, I don't want to be a bhakta. I'd rather be an atheist. I used to be frightened of all these films. They show the poor heroes undergoing such suffering. You say, oh, look, reality, when you look at all these great bhaktas or the great saints or the great prophets of Hindu religion, let me guarantee you, they did not suffer. How can they suffer? They have tasted the bliss. They are above it. So all this is just make-believe, a little bit external. They make a show. Oh. And one day Ramakrishna was telling one of his devotees, you see, I fell down in this hand, because this guy used to go into meditation while he was walking sometimes and would topple over. He broke his arm. So they put a bandage, you know, a plaster or something. And he used to go around and tell one devotee, look, it's painful. The devotee said, painful? It's not painful, is it? He said, you rascal, you caught me out. Mm-hmm. He was playing along. They do not feel. So don't ever think, oh, these poor people, they must have done, why do they suffer? They don't suffer. We suffer. Because we are stuck with the body. And the bodily problems bother us. These people are beyond the body. They don't suffer. Don't you for a moment think that, what suffering? Once you tasted Atman, you suffer. What's the point of getting the Atman then? They don't suffer. We are caught in the trap. Until we are linked to the body, we pay a price. But once you've broken that link, that price is gone. You don't have to pay a tax for the body, as Ramakrishna says. You are beyond. You get offshore account. You don't pay tax.
My question is, it's very simple, actually. It's just regarding sort of a janoy or yagnapavit. Just, you know, what are the significance of the three threads that it's made up of? Also, what's the significance of wearing it? And also, what restrictions, if any, does it place upon the sort of wearer? I mean, are there sort of rules that one should abide by if they're wearing the janoy?
This is nice to get such lovely, practical, simple question, rather than highly philosophy knock the heck out of everybody, including me and the audience as well. What is janoy? What is its significance, and what practice should you adopt when you wear the janoy? Very, very practical questions. First of all, the three strands of the janoy, the three strings that you put on your left shoulder. What is the significance? You see, in the Hindu tradition, you are allowed to have your own interpretation of various ritualistic aspects. They allow you to have your own interpretation. So different parts of India will have perhaps different interpretation, will give different interpretations of the same janoy. So if somebody says, this is it, it's written in Tamil Nadu, we do this. That's his way. And somebody else might say, no, we like to think of it in Gujarat like this. So be it. It's allowed, this variation is allowed. Only democracy is at the heart of Hinduism. So there's a variation. But one particular interpretation that I personally like, that I promote, is this. I'm saying these three threads on your left shoulder represent your commitment to three particular ideals of the Hindus. What are these three ideals? He says, look, that lovely idea. First ideal is, this will continue to remind you of focusing on a spiritual, if you like, your journey. So the first ideal is God, the same symbolically. But I would say a spiritual path, you are saying that you are going to follow a spiritual path, remind yourself again and again, it's only sitting on your left shoulder like a burden. The second thread, they say, do not ever forget your responsibility to your family and your parents. Because you see, they give us birth. Have we noticed in the modern society, even in India, the parents are literally kicked out sometimes. They become destitute because we are modern now. He's saying, second thread, remember, these parents gave you life. They nurtured you. They almost killed themselves, sometimes starved themselves for your benefit. Don't you ever forget your debt or your commitment to them. This is the second thread. The third thread, we say, is important, I think. He says, don't forget your spiritual teachers. They are the ones who guided you, who allowed you to proceed on a spiritual path. Don't you ever forget them. Look after their interests too. So these are the three threads reminding the person about God, parents, and the teacher. Or their, if you like, the respect or the reverence toward these three persons. Never forget it. It's a marvelous, if you like, marvelous symbolic gesture. The second part of the question, I think I should focus. I've mentioned this before, but I'm going to do it again on Asta. Now, you see, the Yajnopavit ceremony, or the Janoi ceremony, is called an entry into the Brahmacharya ashram. He said, what do you do practice after you put on the Janoi? This is what you practice. He says that the individual is now asked to lead a Brahmachari life. Now, of course, the viewers say, Brahmachari life, what is that? So I better tidy up in modern English. It means no lovey-dovey, none, no text messages allowed, nothing doing. So once you put on the journal, that means no lovey-dovey acceptable or allowed at all from now on. Now you see, you say that sounds fair enough. You've got the three strings represent your kind of indebtedness to you, to the idea of the spirit, God or teachers and your parents. Marvelous stuff, sounds very sensible. And now you are not supposed to be lovey-dovey. Fair enough, maybe you are just 8-year-old and no lovey-dovey. You shouldn't be, you know, surely focus on your studies. But the fun part is in the Lohana community. He's a Lohana, so I can talk like that. I get a lot of invitations to go to Lohana weddings. And of course, in many cases, I have to go. They are very close relations. And with that invitation also comes an invitation for Janoi. They are saying the groom who is getting married never had a Janoi when he was 7 or 8. So we want to give the Janoi to the groom in the morning at 11. This is normal time, standard time, 11 o'clock, because we all wake up. Otherwise, Lohanas don't wake up. So 11 o'clock, they're woken up. So they go for the, you know, had the breakfast, they go for the Janoi part. And they first 11 o'clock Janoi, and we'll of course feed you. Feeding is very important. They feed you, and then afterward the wedding will take place. So this is standard. Haven't you all had this kind of invitation? Janoi in the morning, afternoon wedding. Now you see, so I scratch my head and say, these guys have no clue what the Janoi ceremony is all about. So in the morning, 11 o'clock, you're telling the bridegroom, no lovey-dovey, don't you dare, no lovey-dovey thoughts. At 1 o'clock, you say, get married, lovey-dovey, start. So for 2 hours, he managed to be celibate. Now the poor guy who's been stuck in the platform can't be anything but celibate. But for 2 hours, you made sure he's celibate. Now what are you doing? You're making a mockery of your religion, a mockery of your ceremonials. There was meant when he was a youngster, entering the student stage of life, saying, lead a spiritual life rather than a material life or a sensual life. It's just telling you this is a distraction. Don't let this distraction get in the way. Study well. That was the whole idea behind the Janoi or the Yajnopavit ceremony. It's pavitra. You see, there's very purity. It's invoking purity. In the morning, you give purity, 11 or 11, 1 o'clock, we knock it out. We say, pull the Janoi out. You can't now. You see, have Janoi and then get married and lovey-dovey and now exchange rings now. So, you see, we knock it out. So, this is unfortunately the state of affairs of Hinduism in today's world. And we need to challenge it and tidy up.
We call it with a name that it's Hindu, but it's Sanatan. So in that tradition, if I see, there's always been Guru, Shishya, Parampara. And in that, if we remove the Guru part of it, I don't believe that jackpot would be hit. So we do need to promote, yeah. I believe, in my opinion, I need your guidance, that how do we inculcate that culture and what effect do we have of mantras? Because I have benefited a lot from mantras. And definitely I've experienced many different things, but what is your view on those?
The last question is like a huge one, you know, I've got about 20 subsections, but I'll attempt it. First of all, never ever address me as Swami or anything. I'm really nervous and I get, my answers will fly out. I won't have no more answers then. So leave me alone. I'm fine as I am. And the way we mentioned Asta, just a communicator, and I think that's the best way.
He's very modest about it.
No, I mean it. The reason is this. The moment I take on the role of being anything more than a communicator, I become an obstruction to myself and to everybody else. So I'm not doing it out of modesty, I'm doing it because I was out of necessity. It has to be communicator. And I'm not communicating something that is coming out of me, thankfully. All garbage will come out. I'm communicating things coming from great masters. And that is why it is catching the attention. Hopefully it will continue to attract a lot of people. First of all, this idea of where are we heading for? Where are we going now? And how do we, in a way, bring back the youth? This is a sad situation. You see, in modern India, the youth, you see, what we've done is this. This is a horrible thing to suggest. We had a marvelous opportunity when we were interacting with other community, other society, other civilization, of adopting the best of theirs, mixing it with the best of ours, and integrate and produce a much better civilization. This is how evolution takes place. This is the story of evolution. Whenever different species meet and somehow they intermingle, they take the best from both and produce a new species which is superior to the best, the previous two. That's how we have become so complex. From a little bacteria, look, we become this because of this evolutionary trait that we possess. Taking the best from others and incorporating within our system, integrating within our own system and becoming more advanced. This is how English civilization proceeded. That the Normans and the Romans and the Saxons, the old Vikings, they all came with weirdness. But the best part of these different cultures were adopted by this nation, integrated within the system, and produced a very mature civilization. They've done a positive thing. This is what we have to see. Here is modern India. They had the same opportunity. They had the grand stuff from the spiritual background. There's a marvelous science-oriented kind of material that was coming from the West. So they could have taken the best of the West, science-oriented ideas of making sense of the world, and the Hindu ideas, incorporate them, integrate them, and produce the best of both. They're the best opportunity of progressing dramatically. And what have we done? Exactly the opposite. You've taken the worst of the West, maintain the worst of the Hindus, combine them and produce a new culture, a very crass, very superficial culture. How does it become superficial? Let me show you. We hang on to just the superficial past part of Hinduism. It's just getting on traditional thing, crack coconut, do this jano in the morning, wedding now. We just, without real, how does it happen? Because you don't think for yourself. You're just doing things mechanically. They lost all their meaning and you still want to hang on to them and make sure, oh yes, you must do it. Otherwise, oh, dangerous, you must do it. We've been doing it. So the worst of the Indian tradition, the worst of the Hindu tradition, we maintain it. We hang on to it with our dear life. And then we take the worst of the West, the crass and the superficial aspect. So from Hollywood, we turn into Bollywood. And we again adopt it, incorporate within our society and make a big fuss about it. So now you can have this mechanical, meaningless ritual of wedding, including the mechanical, meaningless, crass Bollywood culture. Mix it together, wedding. Here we go, religion. See, we've done that. Taken the worst of both the situation, both civilization, and produce a very superficial civilization, crass civilization. And we will pay a price. How does the price pay? How do we see this? Have you noticed how quickly the Hindu values that we hung on to for thousands of years are now thrown out of the window, thrown out? The idea of paying respect to elders, your parents, your teachers, the idea of disciplined lifestyle, the idea of being kind of very balanced regarding how we live and live with others, all these marvelous ideas, the stuff that I talk in Sanskrit, things like Vinaya, Viveka, Namrata, all this lovely stuff, we threw them out of the window. Modern. What modern? The best thing you had, you're thrown out of the window now. You got nothing left now. So you've taken the worst of both and produced a very crass, very superficial civilization, and we are paying a price. Because all these values are thrown out and everybody pays a price now. The society suffers. The individual suffers. Suppose the youngster says, oh, I don't care for my parents, I've grown up, mature, I'm modern. And he lives a very aloof life and throws out his parents, doesn't care for them a jot. What will happen? When he gets his children are watching him. They say, okay, we do the same to you. So they'll do it with interest. They'll do it even more. So it'll come rolling back and knock them out. So everybody pays a price long term. By throwing out this marvelous stuff, everybody suffers. So even those individuals say, oh, we are okay. We are okay for the time being. Yes, things will catch up with you as well. And you pay the same price. You pay it with interest more. Please wake up. So what we are trying to do, if I can say in a very humble way, is refresh the marvelous material that we have in our own tradition and give it a new home. It needs fresh soil, needs fresh blood. You see, whenever things stagnate, you need to open up the flow. So what we are doing is the Hindu ideas we are trying to implant in the West here. It's fresh soil, fresh blood, fresh thoughts, and hoping that it will catch the attention of the Westerner. Forget the Hindus, the Westerner I'm saying. And this idea will be implanted. The best carriers of this marvelous idea I've been presenting this afternoon, this evening. The best soil, the most fertile soil is this soil. I'm very convinced. And it is here these ideas will mature and grow into a major plant which will in a way produce fruits for the whole of the world. We'll export this stuff. Instead of getting mangoes from India, we'll export the fruit of spirituality from this nation back to India. So the resolution, can I use the word, the salvation of the Hindus in India is via the salvation of the West. Unless the West gobbles up these ideas and incorporates within the system, yes, this is good stuff here, then they do say, yes, yes, we knew it's ours. Then they will adopt it. It'll come via the West. It's a sad thing to say. But this is how I see the thing unfolding.